This is Smiles TV. Welcome to Smiles Television Talk Show. I'm your host, Stephanie Anthony Miles, and we have the best show of all time today. And you know why? Because we have the world's greatest female athlete, Jackie Joyner-Kersee. And then we also have a great boxer who won a gold in the Goodwill Games, Mr. Arthur Flash Johnson, right here from East St. Louis, Illinois. And you remember that Jesus Christ was born of a virgin. He was crucified and buried, and he rose on the third day. Confess with your mouth that he is Lord. Believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, and thou shalt be saved. Stay tuned for more Smiles. Welcome back to Smiles. I'm sitting here with Jackie Joyner-Kersee, the world's greatest female athlete of all time. Here's just a little history about Jackie. In 1984, Jackie Joyner-Kersee won the Olympic silver medal in the seventh event heptathlon. In 1986, she was the first American woman to set a world record in a multi-event competition. She was voted by the Associated Press as Athlete of the Year. In 1988, she won two Olympic gold medals. And in 1992, she won an Olympic gold and bronze medal. She officially retired from track and field at the age of 38. Welcome, Jackie Joyner-Kersee. Jackie, thank you. Come on, Smiles.
Yes.
I love you so much, and
it's
so good to see you again.
Always great seeing you.
You know what, Jackie? We're sitting here in this great facility. You came back home. You've made an impact. You're still making an impact. And we're going to talk about your center. I want people to know some of the great things that are going on. But if you will, Jackie, let's go back. Because I know that you're featured in a magazine that's coming up, and it's called the I Am East St. Louis magazine, and it's published by Charmaine Savage. But you're featured in there along with other sports greats. Tell us about your childhood growing up in East St. Louis.
You know, well, growing up in East St. Louis, in the south end of town, our parents didn't have a whole lot, but we had a whole lot of love in our household, and my parents instilled in us a conviction to working hard, and we were raised, you know, Christians, and you know, and really just to focus on the things that we had and not put a lot of thought into the things we did not have. But it was always about setting goals and, you know, trying to, you know, make ends meet from the standpoint of living in the house of my great-great-grandmother. But my parents, you know, was very loving and caring and always set the rules.
I can remember, Jackie, and of course I have to tell this story, and then you can tell the truth when I finish. But I remember growing up, we all ran summer track.
Yes.
And, you know, I thought you were great then. But then I had a chance to beat you, but you all don't know why. I beat Jackie Joyner-Kersee, but let me tell you why. She's a little bit younger than I am. So if you're 10 and she's 3, of course I would win, right?
No,
it's not that great of an age difference. But Jackie, when you first started running, what were your thoughts? You know, were you just out there for fun, or you went out saying, I'm going to be an Olympic champion? What were your thoughts initially?
You know, my thoughts initially was that I loved what I was doing.
Mm-hmm.
I really didn't understand what the Olympics were about. You know, I came through the Mayor Brown Center, and the Mayor Brown Center had, you know, different sports activities they were offered all of us, and all of us being my sisters, my next door neighbors, and we made up the cheering squad. Mm-hmm. We would cheer for the football team. And then they had sign up for track and field. You know, so, and Percy Harris at the time was one of the directors,
right,
along with Tyrone Cavett and so many others. So I would go and I signed up, and Percy was like our coach, but then it was maybe 10 of us. Mm-hmm. Then the next day it was only one.
Oh, wow.
And I was the only one left. And Percy introduced me to George Ward, mm-hmm. who was over at Franklin School, because they had a track team already. They were running, and I was running mm-hmm. with Gwen Brown, and
right, right.
yeah, you know. So, and it wasn't until later on that might have been a month later that met Coach Fenoy, who was also the physical education teacher at Lily Freeman, mm-hmm. and so they had combined the track club, and we were running George Ward and them, as well as Mr. Brooks and Mr. Fenoy and them, and Coach Hampton, all, you know, got this track team. But then for whatever reason, George and them just wanted to focus on the boys.
And Fenoy ended up taking the girls, right.
Yes, mm-hmm. and if Coach Fenoy hadn't really gave girls a place to be to come and go, mm-hmm. I don't know what my career would have been with track.
You know, you told a story, and I'm not going to tell all of the story that's in the article, but you told a story of how you would see people standing on the stage and they were getting medal, and you were on the grass. How did that affect you, and what did that mean?
You know, when I first started running, I finished last in my first competition, mm-hmm. and I said to myself that if I could improve a tenth of a second if I was running, mm-hmm. or a half of an inch if I was jumping, that meant the work that I was doing for his practicing was paying off. And so, and it was okay. I saw myself improving. I saw my places improving. Mm-hmm. But then I recognized how, I think 4th through 8th was mm-hmm. on the grass, and 1 through 3rd was on the podium. So then I started setting my sights on, I'm going to get on the podium.
Right, right.
I'm going to get some hardware. You know, we got ribbons. I had all kind of different color ribbons. You know, nothing against them ribbons, but.
You wanted some hardware. Yeah. A lot of people don't know that you played basketball and volleyball.
Yes.
And maybe some do, because the basketball career really took off at UCLA. So tell us about basketball at Lincoln High School, and then from there, how you played against some of the great people.
Oh, wow.
Other greats.
You know, we were very fortunate. I started playing basketball through the Mary Brown Center. Really didn't know what was AAU. Poncho mm-hmm. Hamilton at the time was really, you know, getting girls both from that time from Eastside and Lincoln, and we made up the team. And but then my senior year, you know, we went undefeated. Mm. You know, and at the time you didn't realize what an accomplishment that was until now. Now mm-hmm. you can look back, because to go undefeated in anything, it says a lot about your perseverance, working together, and it's a team, and it's a team sport. Mm-hmm. And we were able to gel at the right time to be state champions in Illinois, and really that was something I cherish mm-hmm. more now than I did then. And then going on to UCLA on the basketball scholarship, and you know, I wasn't quite sure if I was going to play basketball, because I really wanted to, you know, make the Olympic team in track and field.
Wow.
You know, and when, you know, but I played all 4 years, and it was great, you know, playing against some of the greats, you know, Cheryl Miller at the time, mm-hmm. who was one of the best women basketball player at the time, who really helped push, you know, at what I would call at that, during that era, push women forward, because Lynette Wooder or Nancy Lieberman and Myers mm-hmm. and all them came before us, but when people really start really yeah. having appreciation for women's sports with Cheryl Miller, the McGee twins, mm-hmm. and then SC having a team, Cheryl Miller, the McGee twins, Cynthia Cooper.
Okay.
I mean, it was like, wow, and wow. we're in our conference in UCLA.
And you were, at the time, how tall are you?
I was, yeah, 5'10".
You were 5'10", and these girls were
6'3", 6'4", and I had to check them, yes.
Wow. But
so I was like a little fly.
But some of your records are still there
yes.
today in basketball.
Yes.
And that's
yes.
awesome.
Yes.
So, okay, so you decided, okay, I'm basketball, I'm great at that too, but you went on the track for sure as a career. How did you make that transition? What made you say, I'm going to do track?
You know what? It wasn't so much that I wanted to make track a career. Mm-hmm. The transition was that the opportunity of trying to make an Olympic team. So that opportunity became a challenge to see if I could meet that challenge. I went to the Olympic trials as a senior in high school, and I finished 8th in the trials. And even though in 80, We didn't send a team because of the boycott, and I wouldn't have made the team, no way. Okay. But then you're waiting for another 4 years if it's going to come about or is it going to happen. Mm-hmm. And in 1984, my opportunity to try to make my first Olympic team presented itself. And so I wanted to see if I could make that team, and I was fortunate enough to make the team. Mm-hmm. And I realized, though, I was in a great situation to win a gold medal in the multi-events, but never been injured before and dealing with an injury, mm-hmm. that it played on me psychologically.
Okay.
And all my family and friends and everyone was there, but I was just in another world. Mm-hmm. I was so nervous and so afraid, and mm-hmm. and I let the heavy bandaged leg mm-hmm. get the best of me. Okay. Mentally. I didn't focus on what I needed to do to win the gold medal. I was so focused on my leg being heavily bandaged that it really caused me to doubt myself. And
I have to ask this question because you mentioned Nino Fornari just a little bit earlier. And for those of you who don't know, Nino Fornari is still coaching track and field today and has produced other great athletes.
Yes.
Did you ever, while running and after running professionally, I guess, did you use what you learned from home? And if so, how did Nino and that coaching staff impact you in the long run?
Right. You know, Coach Fornari was and still is very instrumental in my life, you know, from a father figure as well as a mentor and someone who always taught all of us to give back, mm-hmm. and giving back, giving of our time, come back and teach what we've learned. And I feel the great, I guess the great gift that Coach Fornari gave to me, his words of wisdom, was that he has taught me all he can teach me. Hmm. Now it's time for you to go and learn from someone else.
Okay.
And that was profound in a way, because as young people, sometimes you get attached. And when you're leaving high school and trying to go to that next level, mm-hmm. it's hard to leave the people behind. But when people understand you're not leaving them behind, you're allowing me to grow and grow. Mm-hmm. And allow me to be open to learn from someone else. Mm-hmm. And that's a valuable lesson that sometimes holds a lot of our young people back, right. because other people won't let them go and fly on their own.
Those are great words of wisdom.
Yes. So Coach Fornari was very instrumental in that. Mm-hmm. Even when I would call and like, oh, the coaches, you're like, no, you went there for education.
Right.
I don't want to hear that.
And so today, now you're married. You're married, and you, your brother. We haven't talked about Al a little bit, because she has a brother also who's an Olympian, Al Joyner.
Yes.
So now you're married, and you had some things to go on in between, and we don't have to stay on this long at all. But Al, who ended up marrying Florence Griffith Joyner, Flojo ended up passing. And, mm-hmm. and during that time, how did that impact you?
You know what? Even before the passing of Flojo, you're talking about my husband, Bob Kersee, not only coached me, mm-hmm. Coach Florence, Coach Al, Gail Divas, Valerie Briscoe, Hooks, Jeanette. Mm. I mean, we have a Rolodex of Olympic champions that he's worked with. But Florence and I, we competed together at UCLA. And my brother, who I convinced prior to the 84 games, mm. to move to Los Angeles and come train, you know, under Bobby.
Okay.
And he worked with Bobby, and my brother did win the gold medal in the triple jump, mm-hmm. which was, you know, great. And then I never thought him and Florence would, you know, connect.
But that East St. Louis match.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Sweetwater, you know what they call him. You know, he had the magic in the water, I guess.
Right.
But anyway, him and Florence married and had a daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Well, have a daughter. Mm-hmm. And it was just unfortunate because, you know, after Florence gave birth to Mary, and then she was having problems with seizures, and we weren't sure where they were coming from, mm-hmm. and then come to find out she had a lesion on her brain, and mm-hmm. so after, you know, having a seizure in her sleep and suffocating, that we lost her.
Okay.
But, you know, it was tough, you know, and because as a family, you're trying to corral and, you know, be mm-hmm. supportive, and I don't, you know, I know what it's like and the feeling I felt when we lost my mom when I was a freshman.
Mm-hmm.
But then for my brother to lose his, you know, significant other and they have a young daughter at the time was it's really tough, but we got through it.
Let's take a little break and we're going to come back. And when we come back, we're going to talk about the Jackie Joyner-Kersee Center that is run by her foundation right here in East St. Louis, Illinois. Stay tuned for more Smiles. Talking with Jackie Joyner-Kersee, the world's greatest female athlete, and we are at the Jackie Joyner Center at Jackie Joyner-Kersee Circle Drive in East St. Louis, Illinois. Jackie, beautiful center. You know, people from all over the world, I'm sure, have come in here. What do you want people to get when they come into your center?
Well, you know, first of all, it started with a labor of love with other people helping to bring my dream to reality and to build the center, to have it here in East St. Louis, you know, where we house as well as Head Start, and we do after-school programming. Mm-hmm. We use sports as a hook, you know, to get the young people in the door. We also do work with our seniors, our healthy steppers, you know, we have someone come in, they do exercise and dance. And so hopefully, you know, when people are driving on 64 and instead of passing the sign, they would just drop by, come in and see, you know, not only a great facility, but outstanding staff people, you know, people really working to try to, you know, continue to uplift and keep the dream alive.
You also have a STEM program within the center. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, we're very fortunate. Have gotten several different contributions where we can introduce STEM to our young people. Mm-hmm. And you know, you're talking about science, technology, and math, you know, engineering. It's just four letters to our kids. We want to make sure that each and every one of our kids can read at grade level. We have a reading specialist. We also have tutorial help along with the, you know, we have our computer lab. We're very fortunate that Comcast Charter, who Charter Spectrum is in this area, you know, help make a great contribution, as well as Wells Fargo help with our computer lab. So, but also getting our kids in the space of science and technology, and, you know, but then we have such a large grounds that I'm also working in the agriculture space. That's a part of STEM as well.
Right, and you know, you told me that's really dear to your heart. And give the vision behind that.
Yeah, you know, the vision behind it was that we started just really planting corn and soybeans in North St. Louis, trying to see what would grow in an environment in the inner city and dealing with the different climates. We did soil testing to make sure if there was any contaminants. So, but then what most people were seeing, you're seeing stalks of corn, but you might see corn. I'm looking at it, I see opportunity. There's jobs in these spaces. And how can we be in the space of plant sciences, just being in that space, but then also the opportunities where you can encourage someone to be an entrepreneur, you know. So if you learn how to grow your food, then you know you can always eat, you know. And so it's just a lot. And then being able to bring just a little bit over here to the JJK Center with real big plans of doing some great things in that space.
Another thing I realized also, you are responsible, your center helps go pick children up to bring them to the center, and you also take them home?
Yes. We are very limited in our staff, but we do have an efficient staff that we do pick up. You know, transportation is a big issue, not only here, but across the country. If you go and go to any community center, you'll find the biggest problem is transportation. And then some people have a problem with, you know, gangs, or they can't cross a certain line. But we're very fortunate that they do pick up and they also drop them off. And we have a MetroLink stop, but, you know, still, you know, like some people just want to stay in their own area. But our goal is to bring them all to the JJK Center. But, you know, As well as that's a goal, it can also be a hindrance, but I'm always looking to what's the solution to the hindrance? The hindrance is that We can serve many, but our staff, we have to have continue to raise funds in order to bring the staff in so we can have that ratio, you know, adult to child ratio that we are having impact. Mm. Our goal is to not only bring the kids through the door, but making sure that we see an improvement in their grades and their behavior. You know, they're going through my, I don't have my book here, kind of grace. That
right,
we developed a curriculum around that called Winning in Life. Mm-hmm. And there are 14, we call them 14 guiding principles. And for me, they like 14 intuitions, you know, that we try to instill in the young people. But the great thing about it is that you have the character development, the leadership development, but we also have the physical activity a component that's added to it.
If you had to guess, about how many people do you think actually come in and out of your doors?
Oh my gosh, oh, it could be thousands, but our ADA on average is roughly around, you know, 120 or 95 on a regular basis.
On a regular basis,
you know, our goal is to hit 120, you know, but we hit right at 150, but then it goes back to the, we don't have the staff. So one of our goals is to try to find us a good volunteer coordinator, because one of the things I do know, you know, living in, you know, I just want to say living in our community, but just in general, you know, as a person, you don't want someone to come in and out of your life. Mm-hmm. You know, you want somebody that's going to be constant.
Right.
And if that
right.
person is constant, that person can help you develop and grow. Mm-hmm. Because I always know I can depend on you because you're going to be there. And that's what I want to see when we get volunteers. You know, I appreciate the ones that do come, but they need to be constant in our young people because they see you. They want to see you more than once or twice.
So if people are interested in even partnering with you, other companies and corporations, or if individuals are interested in volunteering, how can they make contact?
You know, they can make contact. They could, you know, call the JJK Center. Our, it's 618-274. Yes.
Right.
You know, spell it out, you know. Mm-hmm. And also, they could go on our website, jjkfoundation.org, and you could also reach us here or ask for our program director and facility director, Mike Greenfield.
Okay, you know, Jackie, we could talk for days and days because we go so far back,
yes.
And I just love talking with you. You are a gracious individual, and thank you for spending time with Smiles. And just like I asked all of my guests, while we have you on camera, will you come back to Smiles TV Talk Show?
I definitely would come back. We have more to talk about.
That's right. Thank you, Jackie. Give me a hug. God bless you. And don't go away because we're going to come back with Arthur Flash Johnson. That's right. Stay tuned for more Smiles. You look better when you smile.
That boy is talking about boxing.
Was a member of the 1988 U.S. Olympic boxing team. Please welcome tonight's challenger, introducing Arthur Flash Johnson.
Whether you were boxing or not, you have to be able to fight to survive, whether it's from a physical point or an emotional standpoint, poverty, if you will. So you have to be able to fight. If you don't like boxing, guess what? You're gonna fight. Boxing taught me a lot of things.
If you stay determined, if you stay disciplined, there is nothing that you can't accomplish. That's what I believe. That's what I live by. That's the attitude that caused me and helped me to accomplish what I accomplished.
Welcome back to the second half of Smiles Television Talk Show. And like I told you in the beginning, we have a gentleman here, Arthur Johnson. And as a matter of fact, I think they used to call him Arthur Flash Johnson. And Arthur Johnson is a Goodwill Games gold medalist, and he's also an Olympian. Come on in, welcome Arthur Johnson. Arthur, thank you for coming to Smiles Television Talk Show. It's a blessing to see you again.
It's my pleasure, absolutely.
You know, I told you when we were meeting, when we first met again today, that you have not changed. You still look like a kid.
Well, thank you very much.
You do, and I see you didn't get beat up on too much.
Well, it was, I was fortunate, I was blessed to have been able to do what I did as an athlete and then walk away from it with a sound mind.
Wow.
That's
and you know what, we might talk about that, having a sound mind
after
boxing, because I guess that can be something with which to deal. But Arthur, just for the sake of our audience, those of you who may not be familiar, if you will, give a little background on your history from East St. Louis, Illinois. What was it like growing up before becoming a boxer or before becoming a professional boxer?
Sure. Well, one of the things that's that I really love about the career is being from East St. Louis. It's a great place to be from because there's so many champions that's come from this place. Well, I grew up, I was born living on Missouri Avenue. You're familiar with Missouri Avenue? And from there, let me shorten the story just a little bit. I primarily grew up in the John Robinson Projects, which was right across the street from Lincoln Senior High School.
Yeah.
And one of the things that happened earlier in life is I always dreamed of being a boxer. I just think that that was the purpose and destiny for me was to become a boxer when I first saw it on TV, and maybe I perhaps remember seeing Muhammad Ali or something of that nature, maybe the Rocky movies. But I think as I look back, I believe it was more like Muhammad Ali boxing on television, which what really encouraged me to move forward in boxing. And I started in 1978. There was a gentleman by the name of Ben Stiff and James Hook. They were starting a boxing club, and I wanted to get involved, and so I got involved. And one of the things that happened was I took the permission slip, because you had to sign a permission slip, and I signed it myself. My mother never saw it. And there goes the career.
Oh, wow. You know, so do you have brothers and sisters?
I do.
And how many?
I have eight now. It's eight of us now living. It was 10 of us, five boys, five girls. I have, as I just forestated, eight of us living. There's three, actually four boys now living. And I should say that back. Is it? Yeah, it's four. Four boys. Of all the boys are still living, had two sisters to pass. One passed before I was born, and then the other passed about 11 years ago.
You know, you mentioned about how many great athletes are from this area, and that is true. And per capita, I would have to think that it's simply a miracle the way things turn out. What do you attribute that to, the greatness that is built in our community?
I think it has to, it begins with a simple thing of the character buildup, what a person experienced in life, and how certain situations that are put in front of them, how they are looked at. You can either become the victim of a situation or you become the victor.
That's right.
So I think
right.
It's a character molding type of place. I remember growing up and having my neighbor to be able to correct me and things of that nature. Of course, we don't see a lot of that these days, but that's one of the things as a character builder, as you move on, as you move forward in life, and you appreciate those things when you look back on them, because those were the things that helped to mold you to be the person that you turn out to be.
You know, I'm interested in knowing, what do you think makes a good fighter?
I think having agility, having quickness, having reflexes, having the ability to be able to elude certain situations, being able to react, I think that's what makes a great fighter, to be able to think and make adjustments, quick adjustments, because you have to do it on a dime.
Wow.
And I think that's what makes you the athlete that you'll turn out to be, how quick you're able to respond to those type of things.
We're sitting here with some of your hardware.
Okay.
And we'll talk about this. If you will, kind of tell our audience what we're looking at.
Sure. Well, you're looking at here the NABF. It is one of the longest reigning lineages in boxing history. It's called the North American Championship. And North American Championship is like being world champion. It's because it's the longest lineage reigning title. It doesn't get the prestige as a world title should, but in my estimation, it is definitely one of the highest ranking titles you could ever win. The other one is the National Boxing Association, and the National Boxing Association was the very first organization that was established in boxing from a world tournament, not a world tournament, but a world-class perspective, you could go intercontinental, mm-hmm. or you could go world championship. And this was the world championship that the National Boxing Association developed. Everything winged off mm-hmm. of the NBA, the National Boxing Association. A lot of people don't know that, but the WBA winged off of it, the WBC, and on and on and on mm-hmm. and on. So it's the two longest lineage boxing titles in the history of boxing. And so to have been a part of something like that, I'm very thankful.
You know what, we're gonna come back and talk more about your boxing, but I understand you also sing. And you've done so many things. You have a book yes. also called Trials to Triumph, and you have a DVD. So this guy does everything, but we're gonna take a very short break just so you can get a taste of his music. Listen up.
I was close to giving up when I couldn't see hope at all. My heart began to fail, 'cause faith was gone. But soon I realized the miracles in me. Despite a past defeat, I won't be. Yeah, I can hold on, I must be strong. There's no time for giving up. I can't hold on, I must be strong. For the greatest moment, for the greatest moment, for the greatest moment, for the greatest moment of my life.
You were just listening to Arthur Anthony Johnson. And you know, I just joked with him because my maiden name is Anthony, and it must be great. And it's just such smooth music, Arthur.
Thank you.
Have a beautiful voice.
Thank you, thank you. And yeah. and about that Anthony deal.
Okay.
Now that's my middle name. Uh-huh. And I had a friend to say to me, everybody knows you by Arthur Flash, so we gotta do something different for the music. Mm-hmm. Why don't we just call you Arthur Anthony?
Wow.
And it's stuck.
And that's the best name you could come up with, so Arthur. So, you know, check out his music as well. But also, I'm going to get back real quickly to the boxing. Tell us about the Goodwill Games and explain, mm-hmm. if you will, exactly what are the Goodwill Games, the place in which you won your gold medal.
The Goodwill Games was used to really bring peace and harmony between the United States and Russia.
Wow.
And a bunch of other countries were invited mm-hmm. to this tournament. And so it was Olympic-style competition, Olympic-style boxing, the event was. And there was, as I forestated, several different countries there, I think maybe 100 or so mm-hmm. Countries that participated in the Goodwill Games. And I was the only non-Soviet to win gold in the inaugural Goodwill Games.
And then after the Goodwill Games, you went on to the Olympics.
It's
a very unique story because, you know, you are our gold medalist in the Olympics, whether or not you actually got it or not. But tell us quickly about your bouts with the Olympics.
Well, I had a couple of bouts. One was a preliminary bout, and the other one was I advanced to the quarterfinals. Mm-hmm. I had two victories in the games, and then we faced against the North Korean, and we lost a very controversial decision, a decision in which many to this day still think I won. And
okay.
Of course, I still think I won, you know,
fighting there.
But in any event, it was a great fight. And of course, that guy went on, as I pointed out, to win the gold medal.
Wow.
And it was a controversial decision. If anyone remembers the Seoul Olympics when they had the sit-in, mm-hmm. When they had the confusion to arouse in the game because of a decision that the Koreans lost, mm-hmm. Which was before the bout that I had, and that really caused a lot of issues. I was told after the games that the Koreans would be suspended from the following Olympics. Of course, now that doesn't give me my medal that I
understand,
They did suspend them because of the things that took mm-hmm. place in the 88 games. And of course, anyone can look that up and really kind of go back and see about the confusion.
Did you knock many people out?
I did, over half of my wins were victories of knockout.
How do you feel when you knock somebody out there on the floor in the cold? Don't they almost look like they're dead?
Well, here's the thing that you think about. When you think about that, it's like a wrestling match. Mm-hmm. That guy's going to either overcome you or you're going to overcome that guy. And nobody wants to permanently hurt anybody in there. You just want to
knock him out.
Nah, you know, put him out temporarily. Right, you know, right. he wakes up, everything's okay. But really, at the high level of this thing, there's not very many knockouts that happen.
Okay, and you are doing so many things in the community. You're starting the foundation.
Yes.
And are there any Arthur Johnson proteges? You training anybody to come up behind you? And what are you doing with that foundation?
Oh my goodness, we're doing a lot with the kids in the community. We've developed two amateur world champions recently, and that was three and a half years, of work of just taking them through the technical aspect, bringing them to the level of being able to compete at different levels, and ultimately the world-class level. And we developed two champions, two brothers that lived in Washington Park. What we're doing now, we're still developing champions. This is kind of the motto that we've adopted, and that is making champions of tomorrow. And in addition to the after-school programs that we do and the life skills.
Okay.
So that is something that is really passionate to me. I'm really passionate about that. My wife, LaTanya, is also passionate
about it. Right, we didn't talk about your
family.
Right.
Yeah, she's also passionate about it. And we see the difference that it makes in the lives of these kids today. It's a huge difference to know that they take from it that there is a purpose, there is a destiny for my life, there is something for me to do. And hopefully someday they'll pay it forward.
Arthur, we didn't talk much about your wife and children. So how many children do you have?
Three kids, two girls, one boy. One's Lakeisha, the other one's Arita, and then there's Arthur Jr.
Mm-hmm.
And they're all in their respective fields. The oldest is in the medical field. The second, the middle kid, is in the Assistant State's Attorney of Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Arthur Jr. is living out in California. He's a big-time musician.
Right, we need to get the whole family on Smiles TV.
Because I should say something about my wife. I better say something about
my wife. You better say something about your wife.
She works in the administrative department with the economists of the world.
Oh, okay.
So there's a lot of times where her brain is...
So just greatness all within the family. I'm looking at this book here called, Trials to Triumph, The Untold Story. Now, you know what? You're sitting here and we're talking about everything else, but I happen to start thumbing through it and... Guys, he has quotes on here from Angelo Dundee, Evander Holyfield. Mm-hmm. This guy's been all over. He has music, he boxes, from Trials to Triumph. And you know, our time is running out,
but
tell us quickly what's in the book.
Well, Trials to Triumph is basically my story, the rise from where I came from, poverty, to ring, being the champion on four different occasions as it ends. Some other things in there that you really want to get the book to read because it really lets you know about I was given 2 to 3 months to live. God pulls me through it, and it's just an awesome story.
Okay,
awesome story.
From Trials to Triumph, Arthur Anthony Flash Johnson. We got all of his names in there. So be sure to take time and get this book, From Trials to Triumph, from our own East St. Louisan gold medal Goodwill winner and an Olympian as well, Arthur Johnson.
Thank you.
You know, we're at the Jackie Joyner Center, and you have a competition that you do right here at the center. Tell us about that before we
do.
We
do an annual tournament called the Arthur Johnson Boxing Invitational. It'll be happening this year, June 8th, 9th, and 10th. Boxers from around the country will come in and display their talent, their abilities, and we look forward. We look forward to having them here this year. We're awesomely excited about it, and I'm just excited to be a part of giving back to the community because that's really where it's all is.
June 8th, 9th, and 10th.
June 8th, 9th, and 10th.
And the name of it again is?
It's called the Arthur Johnson Boxing Invitational. And while we're on that boxing deal, there's a film called Greatest Comeback, The Untold Story. You can get that from Amazon. You can download it. It's called Greatest Comeback, The Untold Story. It's also it's a DVD, and it's the Arthur Flash Johnson story. And it's an amazing story that we were fortunate to be able to come through and to be able to share that inspiration with other people and give them that encouragement that no matter whatever they're facing in life, that there is, at the end of the road, a rainbow that shines through. And I thank God for that. I really do. I'm blessed to be able to share this. And so that's the hope, that when they read the book or they look at this DVD film, that they're encouraged and that they are inspired. And that, wow, hey, if God did it for me, He'll do it for you.
That's right. You know what? When you're looking at these belts here, and you may look like a small man. When you fought, you were what weight?
I was 112. That was the first initial weight where I got a lot of attention at. Actually, let me go back. It was 106 at that time. So it would have been light flyweight, flyweight, bantamweight, and junior bantam is where I ended.
You might think he's small, but you don't want to mess with Arthur Flash Johnson. But you do want to get his DVD, The Greatest Comeback, The Untold Story, all about Arthur Johnson, as well as From Trials to Triumph, his book that tells the story. And you know, you heard that music earlier, and he also has a CD out called Arthur Anthony, The Greatest Moments. You know, all from East St. Louis, Illinois. We have it all right here.
Thank you.
I want to thank you, Arthur, for being a guest on Smiles Television.
My pleasure.
Talk Show.
My pleasure.
And you
my
know
pleasure.
What? He's a minister, too, and we have him on tape. Will you come back to Smiles?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. You heard it. Okay. Thank you for tuning in to Smiles Television Talk Show. I love you. We love you. And we want to thank our guest, Jackie Joyner, the greatest female athlete in the world, and Arthur Flash Johnson. Keep smiling. You look better when you smile. And remember, only what you do for Christ will last.